Hi viewers, welcome to our Electrical Engineering lecture channel for most interactive sessions of different subjects of Electronic and Electrical Engineering. For the latest updates and videos, don't forget to subscribe and click the like button.
Assalamu alaikum everyone. In today's lecture of digital signal processing, we will be discussing sampling of continuous time signals. This sampling of continuous time signal is a very key and important concept in digital signal processing, because it is the main core or main heart of this in digital signal processing, because it involves the conversion of continuous time signals into discrete time and then digital signals, and then followed by any kind of digital signal processing that we intend to have. And after performing the digital signal processing, we will convert the signal back to analog or continuous time signal. So the complete flow of that phenomena is like this. We have a continuous time signal over here. We first of all pass it through an analog to digital converter. After that, we have digital signal processing technique, and then after performing signal processing on the digital signal, we convert the digital signal back to analog. So here we will have the continuous time signal back. Now there are many types of sampling techniques. The most famous one is called periodic sampling, number one. And number two is, you should keep in mind that there is a very key difference in two very close concepts. The first concept is continuous to discrete time conversion, which is called C2D, and the other one is A2D converter, which is analog to digital converter. So C2D conversion and A2D conversion are not the same. To have a further close look, you can see these two points. The first one says that C2D is ideal. It is ideal, assuming infinite memory, means it is conversion from continuous to discrete time. So discrete time is not truly a digital signal. Discrete time means we have only discretized the time axis and not the y axis, which is the amplitude. So this is why it requires infinite memory. But here we will talk about analog to digital conversion, which is an approximation to the ideal C2D conversion. Now ADC consists of three components, out of which the first component is basically C2D converter. So the first stage of ADC is periodic sampling. This periodic sampling is basically C2D conversion, followed by the second stage, which is quantization. This quantization results in finite memory signal, and number three is encoding, which results in which converts the quantized signal into ones and zeros. So these are the three stages of ADC, but in today's lecture we will be only focusing on what is periodic sampling. So periodic sampling means that whenever we are going to convert a continuous time signal to discrete time signal, we will simply multiply it with an infinite duration impulse train. How it happens and how it proceeds, let us start this discussion over here. For example, if you have a continuous time signal denoted by xc of t, like this, it is a continuous time signal, and we have an impulse train denoted by s of t as here. It is such an impulse train which goes from minus infinity to infinity, and all these impulses are separated by time duration capital T, which is denoted as the sampling period. So in this particular case, if you label the x-axis, you can write here minus 2t, minus t, 0t, 2t, 3t, and so on both sides of time. Now if you multiply them together, the continuous time signal and the impulse train, what will happen? Because of the properties of impulse, whenever an impulse is multiplied with some signal, only the amplitude of that signal at that particular instant retains, and all other values become to zero. So therefore, after multiplication, the resulting signal xs of t will be like this. Let me draw that continuous signal with dotted lines, and we will have a thing like this. The same impulses, but now they are being weighted by the corresponding continuous time signal. X-axis remains the same, 2t, 3t, and so on. So this is the signal, which is xs of t. So you can see that this is another impulse train, but this is now weighted impulse train. Now we have already discretized the time axis, but one more thing that you should keep in mind and you should note over here, that because this xs of t contains non-zero values only on the integral multiples of the sampling period capital T, so there is no need to write capital T repetitively. Therefore, we just divide the x-axis, dividing the time axis by capital T. When we divide this time axis by capital T, the resulting signal will be like this. And we also now remove the arrowhead, and instead of arrowhead, I am just placing a dot sign on these impulse functions. And the x-axis will now become 0, 1, 2, 3 over here, and here minus 1, minus 2, and so on. So now this signal only exists on at the integer values of time. So therefore, this signal can be considered as a discrete time sequence, as per definition, and discrete time sequence is denoted by x of n. And this index is not t, it is now n, because this signal is only defined at the integer values of time. If you relate x of n with xs of n capital T, so it comes out to be, and this is because this is a continuous time signal, so you will write xs of t over here. So if you map these two things, you should note that here t is basically equal to n capital T, where this capital T is sampling period. So this equation basically is providing you the connection of T with N. Whenever you perform periodic sampling, you go from T to N by using this particular expression. And whenever you perform the conversion on the other side, you go from N to T. And in that case, N will be equal to T over capital T. In any case, this simple expression is giving you the relationship between the continuous time and discrete time signal. And as a whole, this relationship is describing you the complete sampling process. So this particular sequence, which is x of n, it is basically the discrete time signal resulted as a consequence of the periodic sampling. So this is how you convert a continuous time signal into a discrete time sequence x of n. Now this was a graphical explanation. Now let us see what is happening in mathematics. What is the mathematical model of this periodic sampling? So let's say the impulse train s of t is given by this particular expression, from n is equal to minus infinity to infinity, delta of t minus n t. If you take the Fourier transform of this particular CT, this particular impulse train, so you should know that the CTFT or continuous time Fourier transform of an impulse train is again an impulse train, but with a different amplitude. So it will be s of j omega denoted by 2 pi over capital T summation k minus infinity to infinity. So it is another impulse train, but in frequency domain. And what is this omega s? This omega s is the sampling frequency, which is denoted by omega s is equal to 2 pi over capital T. So it is inversely proportional to the sampling period, right? So now and the next step was, we had multiplied this s of t in time domain with xc of t. So this multiplication can be written in the form of convolution if you go into frequency domain. The same equation in frequency domain can be written as 1 over 2 pi is a factor which comes by definition, and it will be xc of j omega convolved with s of j omega. So what is the result of this convolution? Because s of j omega, it is basically an impulse train, infinite impulse train. So whenever an impulse is convolved with any signal by using the properties of impulse, you can always find out the result. So let me write over here 1 over 2 pi, and I just use the values from, let's say this is equation 1. So from 1, here is 2 pi over capital T. Xc of j omega is any arbitrary signal, so let us write it as it is, and then summation k minus infinity to infinity, here delta of omega minus k omega s. Now these two things are being convolved. When anything is convolved, any signal is convolved with impulse or delayed impulse, only the signal remains at that particular value of time. So as a result of that shifting property, let me write, and here 2 pi will be cancelled out, so 1 over t, and the result will be summation k minus infinity to infinity xc of omega, sorry, xc of j omega minus k omega s. So that is the result, and this general expression is showing you what it is showing us, that as a result of sampling, what will happen, the original spectrum of xc of t, which is xc of j omega, it will be shifted at the integral multiples of the sampling frequency. Straight away it will be shifted across the sampling, across the integral multiples of the sampling frequency, right? So this is the phenomena in the frequency domain as a result of the periodic sampling. As an example, just I can show you some arbitrary concept of this sampling process, and then we will have an example considering a single tone signal. So if this is the frequency transform, Fourier transform of xc of t, who has having maximum frequency of omega n, and this is the impulse train in frequency domain, if these two things are being convolved, as a consequence, what will happen? The same xc of j omega, it will be shifted on the integral multiples of omega s. So that is the consequence, this particular diagram in frequency domain. You see, xc of j omega, this was the original copy, it is at omega s, the same at 2 omega s, and so on the right side and on the left side, and having the amplitude of 1 over capital T. So this is the graphical phenomena. As a result of sampling, copies are being shifted at the integral multiples of the sampling frequency. Now let us take an example of single tone signal. For example, if we have xc of t as simple cosine cos of omega naught t. So first of all, we will need its Fourier transform. So its Fourier transform will be equal to pi delta omega minus omega naught plus delta omega plus omega naught. So two impulses at plus minus omega naught. And graphically, you can always draw it like this. Xc of j omega on the axis of omega, it will contain two impulses, one at omega naught and the other one at minus omega naught, having amplitude of pi. So this is the original CTFT of the continuous time signal. Now we are going to draw the spectrum xs of j omega, which is after sampling, xs of j omega. So as per the theory just discussed, what will happen? The same spectrum, this one, it will be shifted on integral multiples of omega s. So the first copy will be at the origin, here, the same copy. And let me use a different color for the left side impulse, just to show the difference. So here it is omega naught, and this one is minus omega naught. And let's say this is omega s. So one copy will be shifted over here, the right sided, and the left sided will be over here. So this point will be omega s minus omega naught, and this point will be omega s plus omega naught, and so on here. And on the other side, if we have minus omega s here, then the right sided copy will be this one, and left sided copy will be this one, and this will be minus omega s minus omega naught, and it will be minus omega s plus omega naught. Somewhere over here, this frequency is given by omega s by 2, which is half the sampling frequency, okay? And also the amplitude will change, and now amplitude will be equal to pi over capital T because of the 1 over T scaling appearing in this proper formula, in this particular formula. Now, if we are going to reconstruct the signal, the same signal, so what we need to do if you look at this particular frequency response, simply we need to do is to apply a low pass filter having bandwidth of omega s by 2 on this particular signal. Then this is minus omega s by 2. If you apply this filter, so then the output of the filter will simply contain the original signal. If I name it as XR of j omega, the reconstructed signal, that will be like this one, the right sided copy, and here the left sided copy, which comes at minus omega naught, and here it is omega naught. And if you set the gain of this filter to be capital T, then this capital T will be cancelled out and you are left with the original amplitude of pi. So this is how things happen in case of sampling in frequency domain. But one of the key parameters that we need to discuss over here is the selection of sampling frequency. You should note, if we need to recover the signal without any distortion, then what is the condition? For this condition, just consider this particular area. This particular area is of very much importance. We see that there will be no distortion if this particular impulse, if this particular frequency is greater than omega naught, because if this omega s minus omega naught, this particular point is on the right side of this point, there will be no mixing of these impulses. And if there were some kind of mixing, then there will be distortion. So in order to have no distortion at all during the process of sampling, the condition will be that this omega s minus omega naught must be greater than this omega naught. That is, omega s minus omega naught must be greater than omega naught. Or if you place a strict constraint, you can place an equal sign over here. So just rearranging this term, I can write as omega s greater than or equal to 2 omega naught. So that is the main condition for no distortion, which says that the sampling frequency in radians per second, the unit is radians per second, this sampling frequency must be greater than or equal to 2 times the maximum frequency of the original signal. This is maximum frequency of continuous time signal, or you can also say it is bandwidth of continuous time signal. So this particular expression, this particular inequality states the criteria for successful sampling without distortion, and this criteria is called Nyquist criteria. If Nyquist criteria is not met, there will be distortion, and in technically this distortion